doesn't have an A. The Bible is just from the Latin Greek word, biblion, which means the book. Blessed is he that readeth, and he that hears, and he that keep the prophecy of this prophecy, of this book, he or she will be blessed. This book is not just a nameless book. There is no name we can use to describe the Bible, but also it is a respected book. Ladies and gentlemen, many men and women feel those who use the Bible, they are the cheap roadside men and women. People without hope. People without a future. People without a tomorrow. They believe they are the men and the women who believe this book. I'm talking about the untold truth about the written truth. Isaac Newton, one of the greatest scientists of all time, he once said, "We account the scriptures of God to be the most sublime philosophy. I find more sure marks of authenticity in the Bible than in any profane history whatsoever." This learned man said, "There is no other book that can be compared to the B-I-B-L-E. Will you say an amen there? Amen. There was a man called George Washington Carver. Washington Carver was an American African genius from Tuskegee Institute. He is regarded as the world's greatest biochemist. He did a research on the peanut, not just that, and sweet potato, and came up with various uses of this thing. So he was called. They called him to present before a committee why, how he got to know the uses of the sweet potato and of the peanut. And he said, from an old book. The committee said, 10 minutes. He keeps speaking for 45 minutes. Just an old book, he replied. How can a book tell you how to use sweet potato? And thus, Dr. Carver says, it tells about the God who made the peanut. I asked him to show me what to do with it, and he did. The history, the genius of our time, the smartest brain, call their scientific exploit to the power of the Bible. Thomas Jefferson, he says, "I have said and always will say that the studious perusal of the sacred volume regarding the Bible will make better citizens, will make better fathers, will make better husbands. The Bible make the best people in the world." Will somebody say an amen there? Amen. Is Nigeria looking for the best fathers? Is Nigeria looking for the best citizen? Is this quagmire of lawlessness in our cities, can it stop the Bible? Make better citizens, better fathers, better wives, better husbands. The Bible make the best people in the world. Daniel Webster, he says, "I believe the scriptures to be of the Old and the New Testament to be the will and the word of God." The Bible is a nameless book. The Bible is a respected book. I'm giving actual biblical evidences. Then we grind into the internal authenticity the Bible accords itself. The book is a timeless book. Unlike books that have come and gone, because their ideas no longer make sense to the times in which we live. I've been to school and I've seen textbooks that have lived less than 50 years, less than 5 years, less than 10 years. But the Bible is a timeless book. I love this man. He's a professor. Professor of English at Princeton University. He's an author and diplomat, Henry Van Dyke. He says, "The Bible, it walks the way of all the world. It can go anywhere with familiar feet. It enters land after land to find its own everywhere. The Bible has gone to places where human beings will not have gone on themselves. It has gone to the most deprived places of our world. The Bible, it has a word of peace for a time of peril, a word of comfort for the day of calamity, a word of light for the hour of darkness. Talking about the Bible, it has woven itself into our deepest affection. It has colored our dearest dreams. The Bible has demonstrated love and friendship. It has shown sympathy and devotion, memory and hope. And with a beautiful garment of its treasure speech, breathing fragrances and myrrh. Truly, he says, this book is like no other. The untold truth about the written truth. The Bible is a nameless book. That book, Biblion. The Bible is a respected book. It is respected by all shapes of people, from every race, gender, and every religion. The Bible is respected. The Bible is a timeless book. It's not a book that lives within a space and its usefulness erodes. But much more than that, I'm here to submit this evening that the Bible is a unique book. The Bible is like no other, written by 40 authors, or 40 authors who were the pen men of God in 3 continents. The Bible was written in Asia. The Bible was written in Europe. The Bible was written in Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible was written within a space of 1500, 1500 to 1600 years. The untold truth about the written truth. It deals with matters of universal interest. The Bible deals with history. It deals with philosophy. It deals with science. It deals with health. It deals with architecture. It deals with religion. It deals with prophecy. That is why these 2 weeks we will have a prophetic revelation. The Bible speaks to the needs of every generation. It offers solution to life perplexity. Even it reveals the origin and the future of our world. It has brought peace to the troubled heart, conscience and comfort to the sorrowful, hope to the despairing, courage to the despondent. I'm talking about a B. I, B, L, E. The Bible has brought an assurance of reunion to the believer. It has never lost its originality. It was written by men from every race, people from every kind of place. The Bible was written by men who themselves see themselves to be princes. The Bible was written by boys. It was written by philosophers, written by fishermen, written by statesmen, written by prophets, written by priests, written by Republicans, written by physicians. The Bible was written by men who were learned in the wisdom of Egypt. Men who were schooled in the schools of Babylon. And men who were trained by the greatest rabbis of our time, Gamaliel. The Bible. You can't say only educated people read about it. This is what I call an oxymoron of life. Somebody go to school to read a PhD, and he says, I'm a PhD scholar in the writings of Peter. Peter, who was unschooled. People who are schooled today go to school to get a PhD to understand the thought process of an unschooled man. The Bible, written by men of every grade and class, represented in this miraculous folio. If you are a fisherman, your colleagues are here. If you are a philosopher, your colleagues are here. If you are a politician, your colleagues are here. If you are a boy, those are here. If you are a president, yours were here. If you are an academic, they are here. Medical practitioners, here. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible. Are you a tax agent or a specialist in tax? Publicans wrote the Bible. The Bible is meant for you. It is meant for you. It is meant for every grade and every shade of man. Men of every grade and class are represented in this folio. The Bible was written in period when men were in tents when they wrote it. Some were in desert. Others were in cities. Some were in palaces. And some were in dungeons. Sometimes it was written during period of ecstatic joy. In other times, people were in danger when they wrote the Bible. But the good news is that the Bible, this 66 volume, the content are sublimely unique. They do not contradict each other. You read from Genesis to Revelation, no contradiction. When there seems to be an apparent contradiction in the Bible, there is a contradiction in our mind and not in the content of the Bible. I love the Bible. I love the Bible. It presents unique prophetic insight. Isaiah 46 verse 9 to 10. He says, "For I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient of time things that are yet to come." History is prophecy fulfilled. Prophecy is history in advance. The Bible is dotted with various prophetic insight. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible is a unique book. The untold truth about the written truth. This book was well preserved. That's why the Bible was written on perishable papyrus and copied and recopied by hundreds of years before the invention of the printing press, computers, and the steam engine. The Bible has displayed an unusual correctness in transmission. Those who wrote the Bible, we call them the Masoretes. The Masoretes, they are very meticulous men and women. Before computers came, when they want to write the Bible, and the Masoretes open and wants to copy the Bible, they read every word. A typical example, despite the fact that it was written on perishable materials and copied and recopied for hundreds of years before the invention of the printing press or computers, the Bible has displayed an unusual correctness and transmission. If the Masoretes want to copy that, they will read every word. They will count every alphabet. And when they see a single error, you don't write despite, you don't copy D-E-S-P-I-T-E, thinking you know the spelling of despite. They must copy every word. That is how meticulous the Masoretes. If there is a single error, they don't correct. They destroy the entire copied manuscript and begin all over again. The Bible is a well-preserved manual, both the Old and the New Testament. The Bible, one Christian scholar, in the book Evident Demand and Verdict, he says a Christian can hold in his hands the whole Bible and believe he had in his hand the Word of God that has been transmitted or handed out without essential loss from generation through generation. This is a statement from Sir Frederick Kenyon. It's in the book by Joseph McDowell, Evidence Demands a Verdict. The Bible is an enduring book. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 35, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." Jesus said so. This book is unusual. It is an enduring book. They have tried. They have tried. People have tried to destroy this book. The Bible has suffered the most vicious attack. Yet it has survived the persecution of the critics, the hammers of the agnostics, the atheists, the higher critics. They have all won out. There were days in the history of the world. They trumpeted the death knell of the Bible. Behold, it's about to die. This book will never survive. Popes and kings, prophets with our falls, rulers, communists, socialists, each one of them have tried to destroy this miraculous volume. They have died. They are gone. But the Bible is still alive. Will you say an amen there? My dear friend, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. The untold truth about the written truth. But most importantly, the Bible is a revealed book. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. The Bible says, All scripture is given. When the Bible says all, it means all. Both the Old Testament and the New Testament. All scripture. I hear people say that only the New Testament is relevant today. They call it, we are in the dispensation of the New Testament. The Bible says all. When God says all, he means all. All scripture, Genesis up to Revelation, is given by the inspiration of God. Even as at the time Paul was making the statement, there was no New Testament. If there is anyone who downplayed the power of the Old Testament, you have undermined the very essence of your existence, because it was the Old Testament who says, in the beginning God created. Your origin is premised, is rooted in the power of this book. Will you say an amen there? It's by inspiration. The Bible is not the writings of Shakespeare. The Bible is not the writing of any great scholar. The Bible is not the writing of learned men and women. It is by the inspiration of God. God inspires it. God guards it. God was the one who propels it writing. Therefore, it is useful for doctrine. That is why these 2 weeks, my promise number one to you is, the Bible is going to be the bedrock of our study. The reason is, the Bible means what it says and says what it means. If there is anyone who is here under the sound of our voice who want to form a theology, who want to bring out issues of faith, it cannot come from your understanding, from your feeling, from your analysis. Any doctrine must be anchored on the Bible. Will you say amen there? Do you want someone to correct you? Do you want someone to reprove you? Do you want someone to instruct you? The Bible is for doctrine. It is good for reproof. It is good for correction. It is good for instruction. That is why these 2 weeks, the Bible will reprove all the false prophets in Nigeria. The Bible will reprove all the politicians in Nigeria. The Bible will reprove all the immoral in this country. Ladies and gentlemen, men cannot reprove. If there is a source, if there is authority, if there is any power that can reprove, I present to you today the B-I-B-L-E. Will you say an amen there? If that is done, it says, you become prepared. The man of God will be completely, look at the adjectives, and thoroughly equipped for every good work. The reason Nigeria is what it is today, the reason why in my home country, Ghana, is what it is today. The reason why our continent is what it is today is that we go to churches, we dance, we sing, we roll on the ground, and we don't have time for the Bible. And quite frankly, our pastors are clueless what it says. These 2 weeks, it's not a noise time. It's a time to reason. Because whenever God calls, He said, "Come, let us reason together." Even before you receive forgiveness for sin, you must reason with God. So we'll look at what the Bible says, because it means what it says and says what it means. Charles Wesley, who is the founder of Methodist, he got this to say about the Bible, that it can't be just an ordinary book. He says it must be an inspired book. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible is inspired. Probably, and I want to say, the most mysterious thing about the Bible is the manner in which God, the principal author of the book, was able to employ fallible human beings as his instruments to write down his message with such correctness, with such accuracy, with such uniqueness, with such technicality. It is because it is an inspired book. 2 Peter 1:21, he says, "For prophecy," the word is there again, "for prophecy," tomorrow I will make a deeper exposition to it. "For prophecy," we say prophecy is history. That is what? In advance. So anything the Bible says before it occur, the Bible says, when I speak of things before they occur, it never came by the will of man, but holy men of God, they spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. If I had gotten time, I would have done an exposition. The Greek word used there means pharaoh. They were carried along. They were born by God. It's just like you are on the ocean. It was a term used by sailors. When they are sailing, because they are carried by the wind. When the wind is blowing, or it is like someone who is on the top of a mountain, when you are falling, gravitational force have an effect on you. You can't control your movement. The Holy Spirit held hostage the authors. They were carried along. "For prophecy never came by the will of man." Today, when God's word speak, people want to compare with what they think. They want to compare with what they feel. At best, they want to compare with what their founders, their pastors, their parents say. No, prophecy never came by the will of man. But holy men of God, they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Will you say a rousing amen there? Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, they are told truth. Here is the reason. Because the Bible will be the foundation for our biblical exposition for the next 2 days. I want to stimulate just... This evening is just a moment to stimulate your understanding about this book. I can trust the Bible. When my father died, and we were writing his biography, I wrote some of the weaknesses I know about my father. My uncles and my grandparents, they deleted them. They say, "You don't do that. Custom demands when a person dies, you only say the good part you know. Have you seen or been to a funeral where you see children come out and say, my father was an alcoholic, my mother was a prostitute, my uncle was very close-fisted. Only good things. But unmistakable evidence that the Bible is an inspired book. Those who wrote this miraculous volume, God, through a miraculous way, permitted the entire world throughout history to know both the strength and the weaknesses of this man. The Bible never hid or has not hidden from us the flaws of its heroes and its heroines who want to expose in the ruling government the ills of Buhari, who want to expose the incompetence of Buhari, who want to expose the weaknesses and the negligence of the past regime, either under